Hello, everyone. Welcome to NRF Foundation All Access. I'm Katherine Cullen. I'm the Senior Director for Industry and Consumer Insights at the National Retail Federation. I'm so excited to be here for 20 questions. This is all focused on what you want to know about the retail industry. We've gathered a great list of your questions. Thank you to everyone who submitted something. So let's jump right in. Our first question is from Mariah at UNC Greensboro. What led you to your current role? There's a couple of ways to answer this question, but probably the most straightforward is I was working at Macy's in New York, and I was part of a unit that helped merchandisers and brands within Macy's understand how their customers were shopping and use that to make decisions about their business. So they would take data that we would provide them on, you know, what types of tops their customers were buying and help them make buying decisions for the next year. Or say, you know, my purse customer is also tends to buy lipstick when she's in the store, when people were going to the store. Maybe we should put those two categories next to each other. It was really fun. It let me work both with retail and with consumers, which is something I'm very passionate about. But I, for personal reasons, was looking to leave New York and move down to the DC area. And I had been familiar with NRF. I came across them when I was a graduate student. They had been a great resource for me. So I thought, why not look, see if they have anything that would be good for someone with my background. And I saw a job where I literally got to work with consumer data and use that to identify retail trends. So it sounded perfect. And I cold reached out to their HR department and said, I think I'm a fit. Can we talk? And it all went from there. So I've been here about 4 years and every day is different. Every year is different, but I still get to work with both consumers and with retail trends. Our second question is, what does your day-to-day look like? Well, no 2 days are really the same, particularly in a post-pandemic world where things are changing pretty quickly in the retail environment and as a result here at NRF. But just to give you a sense, you know, some days I'm writing surveys that go out to consumers or that go out to retailers. Others, I'm analyzing the results of those surveys and, you know, digging through spreadsheets, or I'm pulling out nuggets and creating graphics or sharing them in kind of different digital content pieces, writing blog posts, making presentations. And others, I'm in strategy sessions with different folks across the organization, helping them figure out, you know, how research can help them tell a story or reach their audience. And some days I'm doing all of the above. It's very fun. It's very challenging, but it's changing constantly. And it moves pretty quickly. So we go out to consumers and retailers at least once a month with surveys. So we're always getting new information in. It's part of what makes my job really fun. Our next question is, how do you conduct research and how often? So again, this is a mix. We conduct some research ourselves. So we're writing the surveys, sending them out to retailers or to a panel of consumers, but we're also a small team and we have, you know, limited resources. So we will often partner with other groups and organizations. So these might be market research firms, consulting firms who are in the retail space who would like our input and our branding on a project. And so we'll work with them to set something up, to do a big study. For example, we did one on Gen Z and another on sustainability. And that's one where it really we can leverage someone else while also bringing in the NRF brand and perspective. And it's, again, very fun, very exciting. Those tend to take longer. So I mentioned we go out on a month-to-month basis with directly to consumers and retailers, but we also do these big studies that can take, you know, a year to sometimes 18 months to complete. Our next question is, to what extent can you predict consumer behavior? Oh, this is a great one. So most of our surveys are actually, you know, forward-looking. They ask consumers what they're planning to do, what they're planning to spend around a future event, whether that's, you know, looking forward now, Mother's Day, St. Patrick's Day, or later in the year, Halloween. And so we're always looking forward at what people are planning to do. And what we found is, you know, typically we're in pretty close alignment with what happens. So at least people are kind of trending in the same direction that our data says they will. If we're seeing an uptick in spending, often that is what occurs. Of course, you know, people are bad at guessing exactly how much they're going to spend on something. So we don't always look too much at the dollar amounts. They're definitely a helpful barometer. But again, we're looking more at, you know, are things moving up or moving down or staying the same? And what does that mean for retailers? Our next question is, how do retailers use our research and insights as a competitive advantage? So there are a couple of ways we really see retailers using NRF research. The first is they'll take our studies or the data we put out and use it to benchmark against their own business or operations. So for example, they might look at what we're saying people are going to spend for St. Patrick's Day and the types of categories they're going to buy and say, oh, are we also planning for an uptick in St. Patrick's Day hats and shirts? Are we also planning for an uptick in, you know, stay-at-home party decorations? And, you know, if that's what the data is showing, and how can we better market that? How can we use that to say, you know, where we should be going? Another way is they might take another study that's a retail study that says, you know, these are the ways retailers in the industry are investing in technology. And they might say, okay, this is a good barometer to show me where I should be putting my investments, what my peers are doing, and how we really need to stay competitive. The second way that retailers really use our research is that we use it to tell the story of the industry to both the media and to government. And this is a pretty big part of what we do. So a good example of this is there used to be a lot of news and media around how stores were dying and there was a retail apocalypse. And this really hurt our retailers and hurt their competitive advantage because it painted them in a really negative light. So some retailers, even if their business was doing well, might have seen their stock price going up and down, or they might have found it harder to get debt or harder to recruit people. You know, not everyone wants to go work for an industry that's, you know, called dying. So we really worked with other teams across NRF to tell a story of, you know, what was really going on in the industry, and saying, you know, a few people going out of business does not represent everything that's going on in retail. And we really feel that was a success, and we helped, you know, change people's minds, which is a benefit for our retailers and for the industry overall. Angelique at Auburn University wants to know, are people buying more, the same, or less because of the pandemic? This is another fun one because it certainly didn't play out how we expected. If you'd asked us this back in April, we would have had a very different answer. But overall, we've actually seen retail sales really grow through the pandemic. They increased about 6.7% in 2020 compared to 2019. And just for reference, the last time we saw growth that large was back in 2004. So really, really strong growth, you know, even given the pandemic and all the challenges that that presented. And we're anticipating that we're going to see a similar level of growth in 2021, somewhere between 6.5 and or over 8%. Again, that's really wild. And there are a lot of factors that play into that. But two I would just highlight for you are, you know, people's lifestyles really changed as a result of COVID. They were doing different things or changing their, you know, the role their home played. And so they needed different items to kind of meet the new needs of their lives. And then also they were spending less on services. So we know that a big chunk of people's budget goes to services typically, but with the pandemic, people were spending less on vacations, on travel, on eating out. And so they were diverting some of that money to retail. One thing I would note, though, is that, you know, those are overall numbers. There are certainly individual households or communities or businesses that have, you know, experienced a much more challenging environment over the last year. So it's always important to take a step further and look at what's going on beneath those top line numbers. But we are seeing, you know, positive trends and really kind of strength on the part of the consumer, which is great news for retail in 2021 and moving forward. Then we have a related question from Meredith College in Raleigh, North Carolina, asking, what are some of the big retail trends you've found in recent research? So building off of that previous question, you know, I was kind of touching on this a little bit, but we can all attest our lives have really changed over the last year. You know, for a lot of people, their homes have become their offices, their classrooms, their gyms, even their restaurants. And so the items they're interested in buying, things like furniture, electronics, workout equipment, cooking tools, they all reflect that. So we've seen a lot of growth in those categories over the last year. You know, even as things open up, people are still really investing in their homes. The nature of work has probably changed. So what people look to buy for their home spaces will probably, you know, continue to reflect that. But then as things open up and people start eating out again and traveling again, you know, they're going to be buying new categories. So things like apparel, probably, you know, we might all want to stop wearing sweatpants and put on different types of clothes. So we'll probably see a return to some of those other retail categories. And then the other thing I would touch on is that people are just more comfortable with their options in terms of how they shop. So we saw a lot of people try new ways of shopping, ordering something online that they didn't used to, or using curbside pickup. And we're gonna see a lot of those trends continue because while they might've started because people were, you know, concerned about their health and safety, turns out they're very convenient. So those are just a few of the things we are watching, but please check out nrf.com for more information on some of these trends. And at Santa Clara University, they're asking, what is happening with the retail industry as a result of public health measures in place because of COVID-19? And there's a related question, where are the growth areas in retail amid the pandemic? So I know I talked about those top line growth numbers that we're seeing really strong increases in retail sales. But it's almost a story about two retails. So, retailers that were called essential and were allowed to stay open throughout the pandemic, often our grocery stores or convenience stores, they have seen, you know, much better growth and much better sales throughout the pandemic because they were able to stay open and serve customers. Categories that were called unessential, you know, which we don't really like that term, but that's what they were called, and had to close their business for a couple of months, or if not longer, those have faced some more challenges. So it really is a varied story when we look at what's happening in the retail industry. Again, overall, we're seeing a lot of growth, but kind of, you know, different trends going on. Small businesses have felt this in different ways than larger businesses might have. And so again, that kind of speaks to some of those growth areas that we've seen come through the pandemic. Those stores that were all called essential have seen a lot of growth. Stores that cater to changes in people's lifestyle, home and electronics saw growth at different points. And it just reminds us that retail's really at the forefront of people's lives. It's touches kind of everything that impacts us. You know, we need items and we need to buy things to kind of adapt to that. I'd also point out just that retail's played a really important role throughout the pandemic in vaccine distribution right now, and, you know, making sure there was PPE and shifting operations to make sure people could buy essential items. So we've seen a lot of innovation from retailers as they adapt to consumers' lives. Our next question comes from the Fashion Institute of Design and Merchandising. What current or future trends do you think will have the biggest impact on the retail industry? we've really seen an acceleration throughout the pandemic of some trends that were building before COVID. So we knew, of course, that people liked shopping on e-commerce. We knew that curbside or buy online pickup in store was popular. But they've grown way beyond what people were expecting for a 12-month period. We've heard from retailers that they saw growth happen in a matter of 2 months that would normally happen in 2 years. And all of this has led to a greater comfortability with digital ways of shopping. So that's, you know, ordering your groceries online, using buy online, pick up in store, curbside, and comfortability, not just with younger consumers or people in urban centers, but those who might live in more rural areas also, or older demographics. Like my mom ordered groceries online for the first time during COVID, and she really liked it, and she's probably going to keep doing it. So we're going to see that comfortability with digital really kind of tipping the scales in a couple of ways, whether that's contactless ways of delivery, but also shopping through social media. We've seen a lot of brands and consumers really embrace that and use that as a channel. Live streaming also has definitely taken off. It's another way for people to experience shopping when they can't physically go to the store. And then one I just want to bring up because it's fun is we always know that a new jean silhouette, and I know we've all heard about the death of skinny jeans, but a new jean silhouette or new pant silhouette really does spur a lot of other types of apparel purchases. So we're probably going to see, you know, some growth in different areas of apparel, because if you're wearing a different type of jean, you need new shoes. You're looking for different kinds of tops. So I think in addition to events and going out and traveling again, spurring apparel, you know, a new pants silhouette is actually very encouraging as well. Shay is at the University of Florida and is curious about virtual dining concepts and asks, how much are you seeing consumers seeking a more touchless experience? And how is this affecting how restaurants are operating? So this is one of those trends that really accelerated as a result of the pandemic. And it's not just restaurants, it's, you know, occurring across the retail industry in terms of how people are shopping. I'm gonna throw some numbers out. It's probably one of the few times I'll get into the data during this conversation. But we do have some numbers that show that 1 in 5 consumers tried contactless payment for the first time during the pandemic. And over a third prefer contactless ways of, you know, shopping or dining out. So that's, you know, payment, delivery, you know, having a pickup location rather than having someone bring something to you, all of those things. And it, again, it speaks to the acceleration of technology in the retail experience that we're just going to see more of that. One of the things I think has been really interesting and applies to businesses of all sizes is just that we've seen businesses across the spectrum, restaurants, you know, convenience stores, small businesses, large businesses, all roll out these technologies. And they might not be doing it in the same way, but there's a recognition that this is how customers want to shop. They want things to be convenient. And now that they have these things in place, it's much easier for them to continue delivering that. I still think we're going to see some traditional experiences in the restaurant or in the store, but this role of technology is just going to become more prevalent. Now let's get back to UNC Greensboro for our next two questions. In your research, how do you see things like politics, economics, technology, and culture influencing consumer behavior? We do see that, and we see it in kind of every way. So in a lot of ways, retail is the industry that's closest to consumers. You know, it's a part of our everyday lives in a way that, you know, other industries might not be. And so all of these factors that impact us as individuals will then play out in the retail industry. So for example, how consumers feel about their jobs or their financial situation, their trust in the stock market, all of that impacts how much money they feel comfortable spending versus saving. It impacts why they're shopping and what they're looking for. I also need to talk about this in terms of values, because that is it's certainly something that has played out pre-pandemic, but particularly in 2020 with the events surrounding George Floyd's murder and other issues related to civil rights and social justice. We've seen, you know, that reflected in consumers because more and more they want who they shop to be a reflection of who they are and what they value. So I mentioned, you know, civil rights and social justice and the stands brands are taking has all become more important in retail and also issues like sustainability. So we're seeing all of that, the way people shop, what they value, trickling back into how brands are doing business, their marketing, and the information they're sharing with customers about products. Our next question is, do consumers care more about the merchandise assortment or the categories that a retailer offers? So it really depends. If you think about your own life and the different retailers you might shop, if you go to a grocery store, you might care more about, you know, quality and price, but also that they have a broad number of, you know, categories. You want to be able to buy, say, both milk and eggs and nut butter. But if you're looking for something specific or specialized, like golf gear or running shoes or something related to a hobby, you might want an assortment that's deeper. So you care less if they carry other categories outside of, you know, shoes or sporting equipment, but you want them to have a lot of choice for you in that category. So it really depends. The key though, regardless of the business, is to give customers a seamless experience and make it easy for them to find what they're looking for. So we've seen this more and more with big format stores that have that wide category. They'll now have information on their app that tells you what aisle you can find something in, or whether it's in stock in store before you even go there. So all of that information to reduce customer pain points that people can really find what they're looking for. Our next question is one I love. It comes from Ithaca College, and it's, what is the one misconception about retail that you would love to debunk for everyone? Again, my favorite. So I think this is one I love talking about, but it's the misconception that online is killing retail, or that people are only going to shop online in the future. It's a really outdated view of shopping, and it frustrates me because it really pits one way of shopping against another instead of recognizing that most retailers today are operating across multiple channels, that retailers themselves know that customers don't want to only shop one way. And, you know, it really misstates how people like to shop. So I have numbers to back it up, but I think it's easiest if you look at your own way of buying things or how your friends or family shop, and it's going to become clear. So you yourself are probably shopping across multiple channels and in multiple ways. I know in my own life, in a single day, I might go to the grocery store to pick up milk. I might stop at a store like Target and use buy online or pick up in store because I just realized my kids ran out of shampoo and I don't have time to go in, but I need it right away. And then I might come home and order something new for myself, you know, some new skincare or buy some new shoes online. And in a single day, I've moved across channels, I've moved across retailers, and the key is I'm happy because I had choice and I had options. And that's really the key, that the retail of the future is going to be about giving people options so that they can buy what they want, when they want it, in the way that's most convenient to them. Let's go to LaSalle University now. What accomplishments are you most proud of? Well, I really think it was switching careers 6 years in. So for context, I started my career in government and I was working in a data unit where I was identifying fraud. And this really tied in the fact I liked numbers, I liked working with data, I found it really interesting to kind of dig through masses of pieces of information to pull out a really valuable nugget or insight. But at the same time, I wasn't passionate about how I was using data. And I also had this, you know, other love, which was retail and fashion. I actually was spending my spare time making a spreadsheet of everything in my closet to figure out what I had too much of or too little of and what I should buy. So it was a little bit more than a love. It was more of an obsession. But for a long time, I didn't change careers or think about, you know, pursuing something more serious in retail or fashion, because I didn't really see a place there for someone who was, one, coming a little later in their career, and two, who really loved data and numbers. And thankfully, I had some folks talk to me and show me some new opportunities, some places someone with my background could really, you know, bring value and really build a career for themselves. And that helped me decide to leave my career, leave a job that felt very safe and comfortable, and switch gears. So I actually left where I lived, I moved cities and started graduate school to pursue a career in fashion and retail. And it's really led me to where I am today. But I try to remind myself looking back that when I'm scared about doing something, when I'm scared because something seems unfamiliar, that you know, you did this once and you can do it again. So I'm personally very proud of that. Our next question is, what are some of the biggest changes from the pandemic that affected your work, and what did you do to adjust? I think the biggest change was how fast we had to adapt. You know, when things change suddenly, everyone wants data and information and insights on what's going on, and they want them right now. So for example, we went from, you know, typically April to October is a slower time for us, and we might do, you know, 7 surveys during that time. This last year, we did over 80, and we were cranking out information and insights at a really fast pace for a lot of different parts of the business. But it's also been really great and exciting because I think people are more aware of what not just my unit does, but also what NRF has and what we're able to provide. And so I'm excited by it. It's great that this piece of work has picked up. And then, of course, like many people, learning to work from home and to set boundaries. So our next question is from Sydney at the University of South Carolina, who asks, how do you know when to turn off work? I want to say, Sydney, that's a really great question. It is so, so smart to be asking this now as you're starting your career, especially given kind of the way work is changing and the way it's, you know, not just about showing up in an office and working in a typical office environment. You know, work from home is probably going to be a way of life in the future. So some things, I don't have a single answer, but some things that have really worked for me are, you know, really paying attention to my calendar, blocking time off when I know I'm not available. And that's not just, you know, I have an appointment. It's time to work out or to run errands or to have dinner with my family, and making sure to kind of schedule and plan that time in. I also try to set a time where I don't check email after a certain time at night. And that doesn't always work. There are projects that come up and priorities, so you have to be flexible. But just in general, setting some of those guardrails so that I can kind of shift gears and turn my mind off, because I found if I take time for myself, I am much more productive and much more creative when I come back. Next, we have a question from Taylor at the Fashion Institute of Technology. Can you tell us about one of your key values that has guided your career path? First, I would start off by saying, you know, key value is I definitely have to be able to look at myself in the morning and feel good about where I'm working and what we stand for. But the other value that I would say really guides my career and has guided my approach to my jobs, it's something I learned early on, which is that success isn't a zero-sum game, that someone else's success, someone else doing well doesn't take away from my success. Now that's obviously, you know, there's some broader context to that, but it's really guided where I work and what I choose to do. It's encouraged me to be more collaborative at work and look for collaborative environments, to look at environments where, you know, everyone succeeding means the whole organization is doing well. And recognizing it's okay to give other people credit. That ends up paying off down the road in your career, but sharing credit, giving other people recognition, and recognizing that doing that doesn't take away from yourself, that's been a core value for me. And again, it's not just what I try to do in my own life, but also looking for organizations that aren't, you know, super cutthroat, and that really do look to collaborate and kind of work together. Our second to last question comes from the Fashion Institute of Design and Merchandising. What advice would you give to your younger self at the start of your career? First, that bangs definitely do not work for you. But on a more serious note, I would really tell myself that it's okay to fail. I know I can't speak for you all, but for me starting out in my career, I felt like everything had to be perfect, that I couldn't make any mistakes. And that's just not what the human experience is. It also kept me from taking risks. You know, I stayed in a career I wasn't enjoying for much longer than I should have because I was afraid of going somewhere else and failing. And I wish I'd gotten better and known earlier that I could, you know, make mistakes, I could fail a little, I could take risks and pick myself up and move forward. Now, you certainly need to, you know, make wise decisions and set guardrails for yourself, but that openness to riskiness, to trying something new and finding out that you might not be good at it and going to do something else, that's okay. The other piece of advice I would just throw out there, because, you know, a lot of people talk about mentors, and I have great mentors. Mentors are a valuable part of your career. But I received this piece of advice from my sister, and it's really helped me. It's that your friends are just as important. Your friends will help you when work has been rough, or you've had a tough day, or you need to talk through something. And I've actually made a kind of a sounding board of some of my really good friends whose opinion I trust. And when I'm facing something challenging or have a career question, I go to them as much as I go to my mentors. And that perspective is really valuable. So pay attention to those friendships and continue to nurture them. And then finally, our last question comes from Emily at Iowa State University. And Emily asks, what advice do you have for college students looking to get into the research side of the industry? And how can you understand and use research no matter what role you're in? First of all, love this. Hope a lot of people are thinking about research. But more importantly, it also kind of touches on the fact that data is a really integral part of most jobs and positions today. You know, whether you're in marketing, whether you're in merchandising, whether you're buying or planning, or, you know, working at an association like me, you know, being comfortable with data, you don't have to be the best person at numbers. You don't have to be, you know, the fastest person with math or wow people with your mental math skills. It's more just being comfortable with recognizing that numbers are another tool that can help you do your job. So some things I would encourage people to do is, if it's offered, you know, take a market research class, understand just kind of the power that surveys offer to you, and, you know, just understand how they work, because there's also a lot of really bad surveys out there, and a market research class can help you recognize, you know, what's quality research and what isn't, what you can trust. Also, you know, do something that helps you get comfortable with Excel, whether that's, you know, an internship or taking a class that uses Excel. It's still a really important part of how a lot of people get data and use data. And I can't tell you how many times just knowing how to use Excel or make something look nice or do something quickly has paid off for me in my career. So I know it's not a like really high buzz tool that people talk about, but it's still kind of a workhorse tool, and it will pay off in helping you understand it and learn things down the road. So those are the things I would recommend. Also, just, you know, look at research that's coming out, see who's doing things that you're interested in, if you are interested in research as a career, and do some of that, you know, career research now, that will help pay off as you consider going into that field. I think those are all the questions that we had. Thank you so much to everyone for sending in your questions for me. And they were so thoughtful. I really enjoyed talking to you all. And you can check out more insights with retail professionals at nrffoundation.org/allaccess. Again, I'm Katherine Cullen with NRF. Thank you so much for watching.